questions. And if you have any questions or comments, we first listen because you don't get questions in that day. So you are free to ask them now.
This doesn't have a point.
And then you will begin the
If you put it in one focus source, it will go into that. Yeah.
And somehow can connect this to this.
Yeah, you can. Because if you take the source and the, let us say a detector or something, and the light is traveling, then you use Fermat's principle of least.
Yeah, you have to extremize that.
So, no, you don't even have to extremize. It is, if it reaches, and once it has reached an extremum, any point by which it reaches should all have the same value. There are two principles involved. One is that you take a source and a detector, and there is some reflecting surface, and the light coming from here to here is reaching in extremum time. But then extremum time means that this path has a fixed length. Because if you take another length, it is either less or more. So if it is getting reflected from another point, then the sum of the distances here and the sum of the distances should be the same. That makes it in. So that is the way to connect it up. So that is also true. Yeah, there is a natural way of doing it. Correct. And you can also do it for paraboloidal reflector and things like that. Yeah, right. Yeah. So, as I said, it is not very streamlined. So, you people think about it. Whatever we have done in the first lecture, it will all look elementary. But unless you sit and put in a little bit of effort filling in the details, it will go away within some 2 weeks. And then you will see, somewhere he derived it like this, but how was it kind of a thing? So you had to put in that effort. And if you notice any problems, if you have access to this book, Sleeping Beauties in Theoretical Physics in the library, you probably have it. In that case, it is described in greater detail in that. If not, talk to me. And any of these lectures, we can take up any other topic. I mean, it is not in that sense very rich. Okay. So today I want to talk about a different topic, which is statistical mechanics of gravitating system. It's a very fascinating topic, and it turns out that most of the things which you learn in normal statistical mechanics, none of them are applicable when there are gravitating systems. That is why it is fun, because it also emphasizes the hidden assumptions in normal statistical mechanics, which we often don't learn when we don't come in contact with some place where the assumptions break down. Okay, and the reference I would suggest is this one. This is a review I wrote, and nothing much has happened since 1990, and there are some follow-up things which I'll mention. You should also probably like to take a look at this. This has a lot of interesting history, because this particular subject is closely related to Chandrasekhar. But interestingly, this is one place where Chandrasekhar goofed. And it is very rare to catch this man goofing on anything. So it is interesting. And I spent a lot of time putting together the history. And this was in one of the Chandrasekhar centenary meetings where we were talking about that, which you may find it interesting. If time permits, I will mention that aspect of your trajectory. So just to give you an overview, what we are talking about here is a gravitational n-body problem, where there is a large number of particles, n, with mass m and potential of interaction, which is just neutron interaction. So here, you can do this in two different contexts. First is non-cosmological, that the background is not, that is what you are normally thought of, like a star cluster or something, and you don't worry about a universe expanding. But it turns out that cosmological expansion, which I'm not going to talk about, but I wanted to give you a flavor, also has some very interesting physics associated with it. The point is, you can immediately understand that this kind of a universally attractive force is unstable. Everything will try to sit on top of each other. But if there is an expansion, the expansion tries to pull these things away. So there are very interesting local equilibria which can be reached, and this is how a lot of structure formation in the universe takes place. This is also related to phase transitions. That is, phase transitions in normal material, like, you know, water to ice or whatever. I will show those analogies. Essentially, because if you are in, if you know some amount of condensed matter, renormalization group approach to phase transition, you know that the correlation functions become infinite, very large, at the phase transition. And the long-range interaction essentially builds in very long-range correlation. So that is where the symmetry comes in. And so obviously it has condensed matter analogies. Here the question which one asks normally is related to power transfer. This is the same thing as Kolmogorov spectrum question which you would ask. Suppose if I have a bucket of water and I stir it. So there is a length scale and a velocity at which I am putting kinetic energy into it and I am stirring. And what will happen is that this kinetic energy will keep dissipating to lowest levels. And it will go to the very low level where viscous dissipation will just heat up the fluid. So there is a inertial range in between where the spectrum of fluctuations has a standard form, which is the Kolmogorov spectrum. Something similar happens even here. And in the expanding universe, there is a universal power spectrum which comes up. So as I said, the right-hand side of this is something which I don't have time to discuss, but I want to give you a flavor that interesting things happen there. And this is, as I said, has something to do with fluid transfer. And the central role which connects all of this is renormalization, because that tells you how at various scales happen. So this is a very rich topic, and if you are looking for a PhD or even an MSc project, this is a nice thing to work on. And there is enough literature available for you to complete. Okay, now let us start with the basics of statistical mechanics before we start applying it into the gravitating system. What one would like to start with in this description is what is called the density of states. So you have a system with a Hamiltonian which depends on P and Q, and you look at your boundary in the phase space corresponding to a given energy E. Assume that Hamiltonian is bounded from below for the moment. So this energy is positive. So you are putting a theta function here, which tells you that you are looking at the volume of the phase space below a particular energy surface. At any stage, if something is not clear, you just put up your hand and stop, okay, so that I can clarify. Now, if you take the derivative of this quantity with respect to energy, this will tell you how many states are there in a thin shell, right? So what one is thinking of? What one is thinking of is that there is a phase space. This is Q and this is P. Think of them as a very large dimension. And then there is a surface. And this surface has E equals H of P comma Q. Okay. So the region inside the surface has states with energy less than V. And if I take a derivative, then you will pick up a thin region here. And the G of E tells you how many states are here at a small shell delta. Now, when number N is very large, G of E and gamma of E will have very little difference. Most of the states are at E. So you can use them interchangeably. So once you have got this, in the microcanonical description, which is the fundamental description in statistical mechanics, you define the entropy as logarithm of this G of E, logarithm of the density of states, with some suitable normalizing factor to make logarithm dimensionless. And the temperature is defined by dS by dE inverse, and the pressure of the system is defined as dTS by dE. So this is the statistical mechanics. Just to connect up with something which you know, just think of an ideal gas. So you have a bunch of particles which are not interacting, so the Hamiltonian is just sum of the p square, except for constant factors. So the surface which we are talking about is a sphere in momentum space, and a normal, each particle can have a volume v accessible to it. There are n particles, so it is v to the power n. So the integration over q just goes for a ride. Each one of them produces a v to the n. Here the energy goes as p square. And therefore, if you take a square root and take 3n, that will give you the radius and the volume. So it is like an r cubed factor for the volume. So the gamma which I have written down will scale like this, and g would have been a derivative of this with respect to e. That will make it 3n by 2 minus 1. But n is like 10 to the 24. So it doesn't make any difference. And it can be g of e. Now you go and play this game with this, and you will immediately get energy is equal to 3 by 2 nt, which is the equipartition law. And pv is equal to nt, which is the ideal gas law. It's the simplest way to derive your ideal gas law, etc., from just microkinetic energy. In normal statistical mechanics, however, microkinetical ensemble is not very convenient to use. So you make use of the fact that energy is extensive and there are large number of particles to define another ensemble, which is just a Laplace transform of this. That is, you take this g of e and you run its Laplace transform, e to the minus beta e. Now, if you plug in for g of e this expression, you can easily show that because of this standard properties of the Laplace transform and this, the derivative here will give you a delta function. So you are only getting contribution on that shell. And that will immediately give you dp dq e to the minus beta times the Hamiltonian. This is the usual Boltzmann factor and this is the usual partition function. So you would have learned partition functions, etc., summation over n e to the minus beta en. So this is a continuum case. So instead of summing over all n, you are integrating over p and q. And instead of the energy, you are keeping the Hamiltonian. And this is what defines for you the free energy by e to the minus beta. Then you can define the mean energy as log z by dv and mean pressure by this. There is a subtle difference between the energy we used here and the energy we are using. In the microcanonical ensemble, the energy is fixed. Energy doesn't fluctuate. Because you are sitting on an energy shell, and energy is fixed. And in fact, things like temperature, etc., are slightly fluctuating quantity. In the canonical ensemble, you trade off this, and you say that the temperature is fixed, and you are putting it in a box with some temperature. But the energy can fluctuate. Because the energy can fluctuate, you can only talk in terms of mean energy. And of course, you can talk about dispersion in the energy as well. What you will find is that all these quantities, if energy is extensive, this description and this description will be the same to order log n by n. So when n is very large, you will find that whether you use microcanonical ensemble or canonical ensemble, you will get the same results, except for corrections which are totally ignorable in normal and practical system. That is how you prove the equivalence of the two ensembles in a standard statistical description. And that crucially uses the fact that if I divide a system into two subsystems, the total energy is the sum of the two energies. So now you can already see why it goes for a toss in the gravitating case. Suppose you take a very large body like a sun or a star cluster, divide it into two. Then if you take the energy of the whole system, it is not the sum of the energies of the two. There is an interaction energy between. So you can easily work this thing out that if the range of interaction is, the range of interaction here goes as 1 by r square in force and 1 by r in potential. But there is also a surface to volume ratio. And the volume has to dominate over surface in order for the extensivity of the energy to hold. And that doesn't happen for a 1 by r long range. That is why you cannot use this in a standard. Now, for those of you who have done a StatMech course, I want to connect this up with something which you guys would have learned but might not have connected up. There is a proof in normal statistical mechanics that any system in canonical ensemble, the specific heat is positive. Is everyone familiar with it? Is there somebody who haven't heard this before? Okay, good. So everybody knows that. Because it is just a two-line proof. You take the mean energy, differentiate with respect to temperature, and you can relate the specific heat to the energy dispersion, which is a positive quantity. So if a system is in canonical ensemble, the specific heat has to be positive. What you might not have realized is that if I have a random bunch of stars, for example, in steady state, then it satisfies a condition called Virial theorem, which is twice the kinetic energy plus the potential energy is equal to zero. Okay, this also you would have done in a classical mechanics course. So this means that since the total energy E is K plus U, I can plug in for u as e minus k. So this is e plus k is equal to 0. Okay? Now this random kinetic energy is proportional to the temperature of the system, so that this quantity is proportional to the temperature. This is the total energy. So you can immediately see that if I compute dE by dT, that will scale as dE by dK, which is going to be negative because this way. Okay. So gravitating systems have negative specific heat, but we just now proved a rigorous theorem that if a system is in canonical ensemble, the specific heat has to be positive. What it tells you is that you cannot study gravitating systems in canonical ensemble. What you have to go back to microcanonical ensemble. And if you do go back to canonical ensemble, something peculiar has to happen. So here is a paradox. Suppose I have a gravitating system and I put it in a box and set the box at some temperature. So I am force feeding it into a canonical ensemble. Okay? But then its specific heat has to be positive. But at the same time, we have just proved that for a system in virial equilibrium, it cannot be positive. So something is missing here. So first part of my talk, I'm going to address that question. Okay, what actually happens? So I have described this, energy is not extensive. So the microcanonical and these are not equivalent. There is also one more minor technical issue. This is not as important, these two are very important. This is not as important. The point is that when you are calculating things like GFE, if the interaction is like 1 by R, then if you put one particle on top of the, if you put two particles on top of each other, you can release huge amount of phase volume. So JFE will not be finite unless the particles have some kind of a finite size. But that is, in that sense, it is easy because almost any realistic system where you will be applying it, they will have some cutoff scale. If you are talking about star, the radius of the star will provide the cutoff. But it is an important point to keep in mind mathematically. Yeah. Okay. So now let me go on to the
question. Yeah. So suppose you just put something like that.
Right. Right. Okay. No, because if you, the point is that when you want to talk about extensive, see, there is something called finite subadditivity. What it tells you is that in any system I can keep dividing it and everywhere it has to be extensive. That will not happen because you have set the scale of the interaction to the radius of the system. Now if I, suppose I go and divide it into 10 parts, then again each of them should have the extensivity. That will break down.
Just one subsystem.
Just one subsystem. Ah, fine, okay. But then suppose I divide that subsystem into two, what happens? Because finite subadditivity tells you that the subsystems do not have a characteristic length scale. No, that part we are going to do by putting a cutoff.
Okay, but I'm just saying, supposing I were to give however artificial way, would it
reduce
to something different? Supposing I make sure every subsystem
that is the case I'm going to discuss.
Okay.
But let me paraphrase your statement.
Right.
So what is a subsystem? Subsystem may, suppose I start with a system which has 10 to the 5 particles.
Right.
Now I divide them into 10 to the 3 set of particles. Then there are 100 of them. Now each subsystem you will say 10 to the 3 particles. And you are trying to limit the interaction to that. Then I will come along and say, no, you are doing something wrong. This 10 to the 3 particles, I can divide further. So where will you stop? You will stop at a single particle. So the single particle, if when I'm bringing it together, I have to put a cutoff. When you put a cutoff, extraordinarily interesting things happen, which I'm going to talk about. Okay? So what I'm saying is that you have to go to the limit of a single particle because the finite subadditivity tells you that you have to keep dividing. Yeah. That we are going to come to. No,
okay.
It is not going to be extensive, but something else happens. Okay, so let me go through it. Yeah, fine. So what is going to happen, I have sort of roughly described first, and then I will give you a model for that. So typically, if you take any such system, it has two energy scales. This is exactly what you are saying. You introduce an artificial scale here, which is the radius of the object. So the energy cannot go below that. Okay? So that you first block. Then you say that at a very large scale, there is a size of the system, and the energy cannot go beyond that. So there is a characteristic radius. Think of it like a star cluster. So there is a size of a star, and the region, the star cluster is put inside a box, and the radius of the box. Now, the Virial theorem, if you work this out with these cutoffs, it will get modified. It will get modified to 2k plus u not equal to 0, but there will be a 3pv. This 3pv comes because of the finite size and things colliding on that, and there is a pressure, etc. on it. And then you will have a u naught, which is a correction to this energy due to this short distance. This is exactly what happens when you truncate the energy at short distances by some form. If you do this, then you find that there are different phases for the gravitational system. The first phase is when E is, the energy of the system is far greater than E2. Then the gravity is not relevant at all, because this is the scale which I have written down. So it is like a very hot gas in a box. When you are talking about hydrogen gas, you don't take its self-gravity into account. It is not relevant at all. And they will just keep knocking around. The kinetic energy and this will balance each other. This is ignorable to this. This is ignorable to this. And you will actually get 2k equals 3pv. All these numerical factors have a meaning. Because 2k equals 3pv is exactly E is equal to 3 by 2k. Okay, so you get your idea there. Now you take a case where this is in between these two. Well in between these two, then you can ignore this and this, and you will have this Virial equilibrium. There you will have negative specificity. We have to come in, become comfortable with that. Now, since canonical ensembles cannot have negative specificity, the microcanonical and canonical must differ drastically in this range. And you will find that it gets replaced by a phase transition. When finally you go to very low energies, the hardcore nature is going to play a role, and the U will be just U naught, and you will just have a condenser. So what we need is a toy model in which you can illustrate all this, and I want to show you that. Now this turns out to be really mind-boggling. You can do statistical mechanics with two particles, okay, and it actually works out in this case. So what you are having here is a Hamiltonian with the center of mass momentum and a relative coordinate. This is the reduced mass, this is the total mass. And you have put this interaction. But I have said that this interaction is limited to this range. Okay? So you don't go outside this. Now you go and compute it. I mean, this is just a toy model for you, and you can compute your phase volume GFE. You can take this thing and you can define your entropy. All these things you can do. And you can compute. The beauty of this is that you can actually compute it. So here is where you guys who are serious about should actually dirty your hands and work this out, or go and read that physics reports review where it is all worked out. So when you do that, you will find that the g of E is essentially given by an integral of this form, where your maximum radius is either set by the energy in this range, or it is set by just the size of the box if it is it can hit up to the box. So you got that. So you evaluate that integral and you get two expressions for this. I've written it down just to show you that you're not supposed to figure out anything from it. I'll show you graphs. But essentially that it can all be done in terms of analytic function. I mean, it is very simple and you can all do. This is what happens. Here is a picture of the temperature computed by this procedure in some dimensionless units versus the energy of the system. What you find in microcanonical ensemble is that the curve goes along this dotted line like this, and then goes like this. Okay? So what does it mean? What are the three phases? First, when your temperature is very low, there is a low temperature phase with positive specific heat. The T increases with E increasing. And where everything is sort of condensed. It is each of the particles is touching each other, and it is that U is just equal to this U. This is what will happen when you make it completely non-extensive. Then there is another phase, which is the ideal gas phase, 3k is equal to, 2k is equal to 3pv. Here what is happening is that each of the particles is going and hitting and bouncing on that surface of the sphere, they don't care about their gravity because the kinetic energy is so high that the potential energy is insufficient to do anything. And here also, as you can see, the specific heat is possible. Okay. Now, in between, there is, you get this phase, and this is the phase of negative specific heat, where 2k plus u is equal to 0. So this is the complete microcanonical description of the system. It has three phases, one phase here, one phase here, and it is connected by a negative specific heat phase. Now, in realistic systems, this phase is very long. That is because I have sort of chosen my dimensionless units to show everything in a given curve. But this is what most of these systems, self-gravitating systems, will exist. Not in this ideal gas space or in this condenser. Okay, now let us go and ask what happens in canonical ensemble. So that you can do because you can compute the partition function. You just have to do this integral with this. Now, unfortunately, this integral can't be evaluated in prose form. But all the properties of it you can immediately figure out. So there is an integral which goes from 1 to this r by a. R by a is a very large number. And there is a parameter which is a dimensionless temperature which is sitting here. Now, depending on the temperature, you can do a saddle point integration of that. This integrand reaches a maximum, a minimum, when x is equal to 1 by 2. So one can work in terms of this instead of t. So when this xm is less than 1 at high temperature, so when temperature is high, this is going to be low, the minimum falls outside this range. So most of the time, this can be approximated as 1 plus 2xm by x. You can do the integral and you end up getting expression like this for the partition function. In the other range, minimum lies in between the two. And you do a saddle point integration and you get a result. So what happens exactly at this point is that you have this, you go from the temperature, which is low temperature, to a high temperature. A phase transition occurs, which is exponentially sharp at a critical temperature, which is given by this. And you can work out the mean energy of this system and everything, and you have scalings with various properties. So graphically, when it goes from one place to another, it absorbs a huge amount of latent. So this is, when I told you about ice and water, it's exactly the same. There is a condensate phase with all the particles together, gravitated. We are talking about a star cluster. There is a condensate phase with all the stars almost in contact with each other. There's an ideal gas phase where they are all scattering around in whatever region it is. And in between, there's a phase transition, just like ice melts and goes into water, absorbing the latent heat. It fixes the latent heat. And the latent heat is decided by the size of the system, divided by the cutoff radius we threw in, and the logarithm of that. Okay? So if you do this, this is what happens. You start going from here, so there is a temperature which you are increasing, okay, and the system follows this straight line, which is pretty close to this line, and for sufficiently large n, it will be almost identical. At this point, it just makes a transition like this to this place. Those of you who know Maxwell construction will think that it is almost similar to that, not quite, but it is almost similar. So the negative specific heat phase, which is here, which was triggered by it going up and coming down in the microcanonical ensemble, is replaced by a phase transition in this canonical ensemble. So physically, if you start with a system and you keep heating it up, at this point, suddenly it will jump to this phase. And after that, it will absorb this much of energy at the same temperature. So it's a very fascinating thing. There is a very critical temperature for this gravitating system. You pour energy into it, that energy will not change the structure of the system. It will change the structure of the system without changing the temperature or the random kinetic heat, just like the latent heat. And this much of latent heat will be absorbed and then it will go into another. Yeah. That is right. Yeah. So that is why I said the analogy is not perfect. You will find that this area and this area are not actually equal. But the idea is that when something, there is also, you can think of Maxwell's construction in terms of convexity. That something which has to be convex is becoming non-convex. So you do this area construction in order to make it convex. In that sense, that is what is happening. We don't want it to turn around and come like this. because that will give a negative specific heat phase. And how does nature avoid it? Nature avoid it like this. Okay. Fine. Yeah. Absolutely. Except for a cutoff at small distance. It is. Okay. Then you have to do it for every potential separately. Yeah. This structure will remain provided two conditions are satisfied. One condition is that the small scale and large scale has a cutoff. That is, you don't go to infinity in the Hamiltonian, should be bounded from below. So you need a small scale cutoff. And the volumes available to each particle should be finite. So you need a finite volume. The finite volume you need even for ideal gas. If you take an ideal gas and you don't put a box, then the phase volume is